You know how I like to speak about anything and everything and bring whatever needs to be brought to light. I'm willing to go ahead and talk about it. Well, this video I'm going to outdo myself this time, and we're going to talk about some really amazing topics. So relax, we're going to be here for a little while. It is the most gorgeous day in California imaginable. It's just a heat wave is coming actually in California. And you know, there's people are going off doing stuff, and I decided this is more important because we are in a tremendous crisis and a tremendous opportunity right now. So I'm going to take a look at several topics that maybe have not been looked at very closely. The Catholic Church and the Rapture. Okay, these are two topics, the Catholic Church and the Rapture. So you can be sure there's going to be some very juicy stuff in here. We'll start off with the Catholic Church. Okay. This is not something that has been brought up before, as far as I know, but we're going to bring it up here. Now, I attend Catholic Mass, have for maybe 5 or 6 years, every week, and everything is fine, but I'm looking at everything and I'm saying, you know, there's something here which needs to be brought to light. What is really going on here? For sure, they don't teach about the rapture, okay? They don't teach about that. That's another interesting facet of the whole thing. Whereas in other Christian churches, there's much more talk about the end times and the return of Jesus and the rapture, etc. The Catholic Church doesn't get into that. What they are into is what's called communion. All right, I've always puzzled over that. I said, there's something doesn't add up here. You know, what is it? And of course, I know what it is, but just the ability to say what it is extremely difficult because it's really, well, I'm going to say what it is here. In order to understand this, though, we have to recognize the situation that we're in. So how to condense that for you? Let me give a little bit of thought how to condense this. We're in a situation where literally we're trying to uncreate creation and to claim that we are prior to God, that we're the real prime creators. Now, just to cut through this shorthand till we get to the topic, we've projected our will to make it seem like there's some power greater than us that is forcing us to do all this stuff. You know, we don't want to say that we're trying to do it. We say, no, this will that we're powerless to resist is forcing us to do this, trying to uncreate creation, trying to say that we're dwelling in this past prior to reality being real. So what we do is we project our will and then believe that this projected will is separate from us and that it's actually forcing us to do everything, but actually we're really doing everything. There's no external will that's forcing us to it, but it seems that way to us. We're trying to deceive ourselves. So this projected will is what we call, let's give it a name, the ego. Okay, the ego. And it seems as though the ego is forcing us to do all this stuff. Now, so far simple, but there's a big problem with the ego, actually. We have a big problem because we told in our projection, we believe that this ego is separate from us, but it's not. So the ego, this projection, feels very insecure. And it even feels that its maker, which is us, is trying to annihilate it. Because we really want to stop projecting, give up this whimsical, madcap idea of being prior to God, and accept reality as it is. And that means that we would stop our projecting, stop trying to fool ourselves into thinking we're being forced into do this. Be honest and say, look, we're the ones who are trying to do this. There is no will that's some other will trying to force us, God. And accept the resolution of the continuity problem, which is the vision of oneness, okay? But because we don't do that, it seems as though there is this separate will. And the funny thing about this separate will is, the separate will, which is just a projection, right? It seems to be wanting to get rid of us. It wants to, because it feels threatened by us, because it feels like It's totally insecure. Well, of course, projections aren't insecure. They're not some separate will, some separate self at all. So you might say total insecurity. All right. So this ego actually wants to undo us. And interesting, isn't it? Because our desire to undo the prime creator, undo creation, now we have this echoing it, where what we made, a projected will, is now wanting to try to undo us. So we're actually terrified of this projected will because we think it's a separate will that is more powerful than us. And it seems to be trying to undo us. So we're stuck with this nightmare problem of what do we do with this projected will, though, to which we insist is separate will, and it's trying to actually annihilate us. Because this projected will feels that only if we're annihilated, that will protect it from its annihilation. Because it thinks if we're gone forever, that the projection cannot be withdrawn. Of course, this is cuckoo, because if we're gone forever, there will be no projection, no will at all. But the ego, being insane, doesn't see it this way. It only sees the threat. Okay, it only sees the threat to its supposed existence and sees that we're the ones generating this threat. And it thinks if it wipes us out, it's home, safe and free. So we're so afraid of this projected will that we think is more powerful than our will. And we're trying to figure out how do we protect ourselves from this. So we kind of are trying to make a peace treaty with this projected will and this ego, and we're trying to find out why is it so mad? Why is it so angry at us? Why is it such a wrathful God? We even think it's God. We call it God, you know, this projected will. We say, why, God, why are you so angry at me? Why do you hate me so much? Why do you want to destroy me? Why are you treating me with death and all this stuff? And we're trying to figure out what can we do to make you happy, to appease your wrath. Sound familiar? So, we have been trying to figure out how can we appease this wrathful deity that seems to want to annihilate us. Well, this wrathful deity, the ego, seems to respond to us, and it says, there is a way, there is a way, there is a way to appease my wrath and calm my wrath. And we say, great, 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 okay. Just tell us what the way is. So this ego says, look, what you gotta do, I'm gonna have a scenario for you that's gonna work, okay? You just have to follow along. All right. And so the scenario is, I'm going to send my son, the son, spirit, my son, the spirit, the ego saying this, into the world. And then you have to kill my son. Okay, all right. Let me say, Wow, what's going on? Well, in order to show your loyalty to me, okay. So far we're like, kind of like, this is a little strange. Then, once this the son of the ego really is dead, the ego claims that it will no longer be angry. Well, why does this seem to make sense? Because again, it's the true son of God is the one who is projecting the ego. So the ego feels if this true son of God dies, there'll be no more fear of withdrawing that projection. So we have this situation of being told we're supposed to kill the son of God, and that will solve the problem. So supposedly this is what happened with Jesus. Now, this is the ego's remedy for its wrath, okay, which is really to annihilate us. But we weren't annihilated, you know. Jesus was resurrected, and it says, "Look, you can't die." Well, put that aside for right now. What happened was then we didn't die, but the ego says, "Ah, there's one more step you got to take, and that is you need to die." Well, the ego didn't put it that way. Here's the trick. The ego said, great, you did the job. You did it. You killed the Son of God. That appeased me, but there's one more step you have to take. Okay. And you have to... what you have to do now is conform yourself to this sacrifice so that I can be truly happy and know that you're loyal to the sacrifice. And the way to do that is to eat the body and drink the blood of the dead body of the Son of God. And we say, wow, that's really weird. What's going on? And the ego says, if you do that, you shall be saved, and I will put you in paradise, and there will never be any problem again whatsoever with you. You'll be saved. Therefore, we have what's called communion, where the priest supposedly turns the communion wafer into the literal body and blood of Jesus. But of course, from the ego standpoint, that's a dead body. It's a dead God. It's God in a dead state. They say, we accept the death of your Son. And as we take partake of this, we're accepting the death of your Son. They're saying that. Now, eating the dead body, flesh, and blood of God, we say, how does that save us? Here's the thing. The ego believes that by doing that, it will actually kill all of us. It will actually kill all of us. Our spirit, the ego believes this is the way to kill our spirit, is you eat the flesh and drink the blood of the dead Son of God. And since we're all Son of God too, that this will poison us and kill us too. And then the ego says, well, when you're all dead, I'll be happy and free. So the goal is reached. You ask me, how can I be happy? And this is the way, is if you're all dead. If you're all spiritually annihilated, then I will be happy and free and not wrathful anymore. So what was actually taking place is people are trying to annihilate their spirit this way. This is what they're actually trying to do. But they think they're pleasing God, but they're really interacting with the ego. Okay, they're really interacting with the ego. And the ego is told them there is a way to please God so that no more wrath from the ego. Well, if we're all spiritually annihilated, it's a moot point whether the ego is wrathful or not, right? Because we're not there to receive the wrath in the first place. So this is the bizarre situation that we find ourselves in. And those who go in that direction feel that this world is going to be made into a paradise because God's wrath will have been appeased. But keep in mind one thing. Jesus resurrected from the dead and said, you cannot kill spirit, right? So that plan is not going to work. It's not going to work at all. And even if it did work and you have a happy ego, we'd be annihilated and we wouldn't be able to experience it in the first place. So it's a lose-lose-lose from the very beginning attempt, remedy. But this has not been brought to light as far as I know, what's really going on. And it's simply a mistake that has to be corrected. We'll get into that later now. So the idea that there'll be a paradise here on earth, of course they don't want to be raptured because they believe that paradise is going to be here on earth because, quote-unquote, God, the ego, will have been appeased and is no longer angry with us and will make everything lovey-dovey and perfect here. But the truth is that the only way appeasement the ego will ever accept is our spiritual annihilation. That's the only remedy there could possibly be, even though it's an insane remedy because then the ego would disappear too. But it's the only plausible remedy the ego has. It's the only recourse the ego has is to pursue this direction. It can't pursue any other direction. It cannot admit that it's a projection because we told it it's a separate will. And so to say that it's not a separate will, it doesn't have the will to do that because we didn't give it the will to do that. It's not a separate will. We don't have the will to create a separate will. So the ego cannot assert that it's a separate will. It only is trying to get rid of the threat to what it sees as its existence. And so the idea of eating the flesh of the God that's dead will make us dead too. That's its master plan. Okay. So, Of course, if you think this world is going to be a paradise, you're not going to think about rapture. But the final words that Jesus gave when he was leaving, saying, I'm going to be not troubled. If there were not many rooms in my Father's mansion, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you, and at the end of the age to come back and take those who want to, with me to dwell in the place, to dwell with me in that place. So, if this is to be believed, then it sounds like there is a relocation going to take place. And now, of course, if you've been pursuing this plan of trying to appease God's wrath, thinking that God's wrathful, and thinking that all your loyalty to this is going to give you a prime place, prime situation in this world, you're not going to want to leave this world. You're going to believe that God is going to smite all your enemies, destroy them all, and you'll have no more enemies, and you'll be happy here ever after. Overlooking the fact that your real enemy is the ego, and the ego has not been appeased, because the only way the ego can be appeased is your own annihilation. So the ego will actually come looking for you too. But this is the fantasy that people have, is that they think that if they stay here, everything's going to be great. All those that they don't like, that think they cause them problems or worried about them, will be annihilated. But what they really mean is God's going to smite all its enemies. But keep in mind that this ego, to the ego, we're all the ego's enemies. In fact, we're all the ego's mortal enemies. So if the ego had its way, it would smite every last one of us. Doesn't sound like a very good scenario. Now, shift, you go to the rapture. Harold Camping, the broadcaster from, I believe, Oakland, East Oakland or Oakland, who passed away recently, he was the one that said May 21st, 2011 was going to be the rapture. And there were billboards all over. I mean, the Bay Area, there are billboards everywhere. I think it was a national campaign, and he got worldwide press. Of course, it didn't happen. So what happened? The whole idea of the rapture got discredited among the mainstreams. Like, you're crazy. Remember that crazy preacher guy? This is called a false flag. This is called a disinformation campaign. This is something the ego loves to do. Is in order to discredit something that's truly important, before it happens, there'll be some false date set and really promoted around the world. And then when it doesn't happen, it'll discredit the true situation that's coming later. This is classic operations for misdirection here. So, you know, the guy was wrong about the date. Okay, he was absolutely wrong. That doesn't mean it's not going to happen. Now, we're not going to set hard dates here. For this situation, I don't have details. There's a reason why I don't have details, is because the government and the bureaucracy, the global bureaucracy, global governance, they don't want anybody to leave this planet. Why? They need our revenue. They need our revenue. They need our tax money. They need our property taxes. They need our revenue. Okay? They don't want, you know, a billion people to leave this planet suddenly. Not the governance. There might be, the New World Order might like that in some way. Some people may want, you know, the depopulation to take place. But in terms of bureaucracy and entrenched bureaucracy, no. They want as big a tax base as possible. So they don't want this story spread around. They want to discredit it. Because people might start thinking, say, hey, wait a minute. This world is not a paradise. It'll never be a paradise. This whole notion of appeasing a wrathful God is insane. There isn't. That's on my own projection. They may start waking up and say, you know what, I don't need to stay here. I have options. My power of decision gives me options. So in this world, there's a concerted effort to keep us all unaware of what our options are and unaware of what our real power is, which is the power of decision, really. Power of decision. Male person, the power of decision gives us the ability to choose. It absolutely does. So we are told that this world is the only place there is. There's nowhere else we can go. We are citizens of this country. We belong to the state. They own us. And therefore, we just simply have to be. simply have to be wage slaves and tax slaves for, you know, the whole rest of our life. And to have the idea of the rapture popularized, definitely not. Now, so you do not see very much talk about it, actually. It's been suppressed. People's spirits and their will and their power to decide has been suppressed on this planet into thinking that their options are narrowed, like cattle, where the cattle think, this is my pen, there's nowhere else to go. Very convenient for, you know, bureaucracy. What does a bureaucracy want? It wants everything to be smooth and easy. Smooth and easy. It wants us all to be brainwashed and conditioned and go along like cattle with all the taxes and all the revenues and all the levies and the fines and behavioral controls and all that kind of stuff. And they certainly don't want us, the tax base, vanishing from this planet. So you have an enormous vested interest in this world in not talking about the rapture. And the Catholic Church, of course, does not talk about it because they have a different plan of thinking there's a way to appease the ego's wrathful desire for the sacrifice of the Son of God. And they think, yeah, okay, we accepted the sacrifice of the Son of God. We are now partaking of that sacrifice, and that's going to make the ego happy. It doesn't make the ego happy because it wants to annihilate our spirit. And Jesus showed us through the resurrection, our spirit cannot be annihilated. The body can be killed, but not the spirit. Now, we are spirit. We also have mind that does what we ask to do. It presents our ideas to us, our experiencing to us. And I think Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body. Fear those who can kill both the body and the soul. Okay. So in this day and age, they meant the mind. It's not spirit. Spirit can't die. Mind can't die either, really. What they mean is to repress the will, repress the capability to choose. Kill the soul, meaning make you think, make you believe that you can die. That's what it really means. It's a belief system. It's a belief situation. And that causes us to be enmeshed in enormous delay. And what's happening in the world now is there's this war against the mind. Okay. A war against the mind. It's trying to capture the mind's belief and say, mind, you don't have the power. You can't choose. You don't. Spirit, you don't have the power. You don't have the will. That's a psych job, okay? And they're trying to psych us out, thinking that we don't have the capacity to choose. Choose a new belief system, choose a new direction, choose a new dwelling place, choose the vision of oneness. They're trying to make us think that it's impossible for us. So that is what should really be feared. And that's, I said, the World War III broke out in March 10th, meaning that this campaign to bring about this terrible, ruinous reign of darkness has decided to strike and strike very hard, which justifies calling it the outbreak of war. It's a war against your spirit. It's a war against your freedom. And We're looking for spiritual help, but where do we get it? Where do we get it? We get some platitudes, you know, some platitudes of, whatever. But this situation here needs to be addressed clearly, without fear. And we say this plan of the egos to annihilate us doesn't work, can never work. It's crazy from the very beginning. So we don't need to try and kill ourselves, deaden our spirits. And we don't need to trust that the ego will somehow bring peace to this planet. The ego can never bring peace. It's impossible. So this brings us to the present moment, which, now I was told that from February 17th, President's Day, to the 17th, St. Patrick's Day of March, 17th of March, I think that's St. Patrick's Day. But anyway, the 17th of March, a month period, it was all important to make final preparations for something very, very significant as far as our future goes. Our future direction is at stake, because it most definitely is. There's an attempt by the global powers to convince us that we're incapable of doing anything but following their lead, okay? That they're entitled to tell us what to do. That we don't have any entitlement from the true God, the one true God, to cast aside delusions, to accept the remedy for our continuity problem, to abide in the vision of oneness and be reminded what reality is really like. They're trying to convince us we have no such capability and never did, and that following their lead is the way to salvation and happiness. So this is a campaign, an ideological campaign against truth, really, against truth. So I was told that this campaign was going to get into full gear in early March, and that by the 17th, we would need to be ready for some sort of boost in some way. Now, I don't have details at this point, but there are indications that some sort of, you know, there, like I said, it's a war, so some sort of a commission will be given us, some sort of posting orders, like when you're in a war, you're commissioned, commissioned as an officer, then you're sent to a certain post, a location, etc. Those kind of things may begin to take place here as this situation begins to sort itself out. It needs to sort itself out. And how could we do that if we don't have the clear light of reason to sort it out? It has to be sorted out. It's a mess. It is a mess. I mean, Bert there. It's an incredible mess. Now, when you attempt to accomplish the impossible, which is to uncreate creation, it's going to be a mess because nothing works. And the more it doesn't work, the more we make crazy defenses against realizing it doesn't work. And so all these defenses don't fit together in a nice, neat package. It's a jumble. It's a jumble. It really is a jumble. And we just kind of are just whimsically, chaotically trying all these defenses, one fear defending against another, and that's another. But it's important just to look at these defenses and just see them. Just see them. Just see for what it is. Say, okay. It's not going to add up into a nice, neat little package, you know. But the vision of oneness is a nice, neat little, beautiful vision. Okay. It's not all jumbled or chaotic. It's just one vision. Not two, just one. Not two, just one. And that shows us this totally serene, unchaotic, unconfused, unconflicted meaning, totally unified, the meaning of totality, the meaning of total non-exclusion. How does total non-exclusion feel? How does that meaning feel to us? That's the vision of oneness. That's what saves us from our continuity fears. So far so good. We've brought to light the one of the great mysteries. You know, this whole thing about eating the flesh of a dead god is actually predated Christianity, predated Catholicism. It was something that just continued on. It's always been at the root of the ego's plan, is to, the ego's thinking, how do I annihilate my maker? And it thinks that, you know, this is the way we can do it. And of course, we're told that there can never be peace on the world until everybody is converted and everybody is eating the flesh of dead, blood of dead God. And everybody, therefore, will be annihilated, and then there'll be happiness because the ego will be happy. We just take the ego's word for it as if it were God about what makes you happy, you know. Well, God has never not been happy. We don't have to ask God what makes God happy, because God is always perfectly happy. So we don't have to appease a wrathful God. We don't have to sacrifice. We don't have to bring death into the equation at all. That's only for the ego. So the capacity to see through a situation is definitely within us, because I've done it. How did I do it? Because Jesus explained it to me, basically. And said, look, they misinterpreted, you know, they twisted it and turned it into an egoic thing. and that's not right. It doesn't correct the mistake that I came to correct. So we definitely have the capacity to see this and clarify it and sort stuff out. We do, no question about it. You just have to value it. You just have to value doing that. You say it's a very valuable thing to do. And then it can be done. If we don't value it, then of course we won't do it. If we think we're appeasing a wrathful God, we value that. And we say, I gotta do that, I gotta do that, I gotta do that. So, as far as the rapture goes, I don't have dates, I don't have details, I'm not sure what's going to happen. But it is certainly possible that a relocation of some sort will take place, a sorting out process will take place. It needs to happen because there is this enormous push on this planet now to plunge this planet into spiritual darkness. And way back in 1997, I was shown like a video when I was asleep. I was shown this video, it was like a carpet rolling out, and I was shown all the events of the future. And so I've just been noticing these over the last 16, how long has it been? It's been 17 years. And everything that was shown has happened. It's all happening. And what I was shown happened next is, for one, I was shown the collapse of fiat currency is going to take place. And very shortly after that is this extreme blackness, darkness. The road just goes into this pitch darkness. It's horrible, you know. So what I have seen is this planet is going to be plunged into spiritual darkness, which means you don't, a situation where you don't, you're following the ego and you feel you have no option but to do so. And your spiritual will seems to have vanished on you. That's what darkness is, very dark. So those who choose God's gift, who are willing to accept the gift that God has given us, which is the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is what God, not, God didn't give us some sacrifice to appease God. God gave us the vision of oneness. And gave us Jesus to show that we have eternal life. We're eternal life. Spirit's eternal life. It can kill the body, but it can't kill the spirit. So, but we have the vision of oneness. That's the gift that God has given to us. So those who elect to receive the gift that God has given them and say, the vision of oneness is mine to keep. You know, the past belongs to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit sort all this out. We don't have to go through this spiritual darkness. We don't have to go through this time. It doesn't help us at all. In fact, it would actually cause us to feel disempowered and that we don't have the power of decision, power of will, power of choice. We don't have the vision of oneness. It would make us feel that all that stuff was just mythical, delusional psychosis. Because they really will claim it's psychosis, and they will give you drugs, and they will do all sorts of therapy. Brainwave therapy on you, surgery, drugs, radiation, all sorts of stuff to try and get rid of this, what they see as a dangerous psychosis that is threatening the peace that they believe they're going to get from accepting the egoic belief in the ego, actually. Now, not everybody believes that the ego is God. Some just believe that they don't concretize it into God. What they just say is, well, this is just our life, this is what we are, and that's it. We're just a human being in this world, and this is the condition. We have no choice but to you know, go along with all that. It's the same thing, because it's saying that there's some external will that has made all this, some external will external to us that has made everything, and we are just pawns in this. We're nothing. We're just grains of sand. There's nothing we can do about it. That's the exact same thing. It's just some decide not to call it God. Some call it the ego and worship directly the ego. Say, I gotta build a healthy ego. I gotta build a healthy self. I gotta build a healthy esteem. What is the self-esteem? It means esteeming the ego, actually. It means esteeming the ego. is what they're really talking about. So all this empowerment and self-esteem stuff is really about saying, how can I accept the ego more? How can I accept it more? How can I be happy with the ego? How can I make the ego feel that it's great, you know? Because I feel this insecurity. I want to build the ego up. How do I live my life to build the ego up, make it feel less insecure? It's essentially the same thing as calling the ego God. It's essentially the same thing. The dynamic's the same. How do I make this God happy? How do I make whatever it is happy that I need to make happy here, so I don't feel so insecure myself? Now, of course, we have bodies. These bodies, well, the ego wants to kill us, wants to kill spirit. And so spirit said, what can I do, ego? I mean, to make you not so angry with me, don't kill me. And the ego says, well, I need to sacrifice. I need to, you know, kill something here. So we made bodies. And of course, death made death. Everything dies. And we're feeding this ego, thinking, the ego says, yeah, you see, I can destroy everything. I can destroy our bodies. And the spirit said, yeah, this body is me. And so you're destroying me by destroying the body. Of course, the ego feels this, that spirit's lying to it. It doesn't trust spirit. Of course, because the body is not spirit. So what the ego does is it really wants to get to the spirit and kill the spirit. Killing these bodies is not enough for the ego. It's not enough. So this is information that's not been given out before, really. Because people are really not ready for it, most people, and nobody's really willing to say this because it seems like it's too risky of an endeavor. But of course, Jesus said, "Look, to those who are given much, much is expected," and he said, "If you don't testify of what I have told you, then I will say I don't know you," not in a mean-spirited way, but. We would say, Jesus, I don't know you. Because I haven't been sharing your information. So how can I say I really know you? So this information has been made clear to me through the work of Jesus, actually. A Course in Miracles, primarily. And the Bible, too. Because the truth is in there, too. And so it's incumbent upon me to share it, actually. I don't want the situation where Jesus said, hey, you knew this information, how come you didn't share it? Yeah, and I'd say, like, that's not good, that's not right. You know, what are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? But I want people to realize it can be sorted out. It really can be sorted out, even though it seems very difficult. And there are these blocks that seem particularly scary, because you don't want to say that this is what the Catholic Church has been doing for all these years. And of course, the Christian Church in general, holding Jesus up as a sacrifice to atone for sins, that is the ego. You're trying to placate the ego, not God. God doesn't need to be placated. Jesus said God is a God of love, not anger. Perfect love casteth out all fear. So therefore, God is a God of perfect love. There can't be have any fear in God. Since there's no fear, there's no anger. There's no anger, there's nothing to be appeased. See, God is not vulnerable. We believe God is vulnerable because we want to be prime creator. We want to say that we can uncreate creation and say that we are the ones behind God. Behind the scenes, prior to God, we made God. We want to say that we made God out of compounding particles, and that God is some super particle that we have actually figured out how to compound. So all these scientists are busy working here, and you know what are they trying to do? They're really trying to compound God. They're trying to create, make a God particle, as it were. And it's not possible. This is just totally, totally delusional stuff that's going on. But we are so scared to drop all this because the continuity is fear. We keep on. Here's the thing. If we can't drop all this madness, then we have to justify it to ourselves somehow because we're stuck with it. So we have to say, yeah, it's all necessary. It's all appropriate. It's all natural. This is what I really want to do. There is no other option. We have to justify it to ourselves, trying to get rid of the terrible taste that it has for us. and we think we can just justify it to ourselves sufficiently, that terrible taste will go away. It never does. It never does. That's not the way. We have to accept the vision of oneness, the power of choice, the power of decision that rests with me. I can choose the vision of oneness. I'm entitled to the vision of oneness. We're all entitled to it. We're entitled to the gifts of God because God gave these gifts to us. So we cannot reject them. We cannot reject the gift of the vision of oneness. We're entitled to it. We're entitled. It belongs to us, and we have to accept it and keep it and abide in it. That is our, with no way around that. So we might as well do it. We might as well say, yeah, okay, this is what belongs to me. Now, we're so used to the ego giving us stuff and thinking the ego's God and realizing the ego's gifts are terrible, that we don't want to hold on to anything the ego gives us. We think the ego gave us this body, even though we did. And we don't like the body. We don't want to hold on to the body. But the vision of oneness is not a body. Okay. It's seeing all things as sharing the just one identity, that all are that identity. It's hard to describe because concepts get in the way. But it's seeing perfect non-exclusion in the one identity, in the totality of perfect non-exclusion. Perfect non-exclusion in perfect non-exclusion. Yeah, sort of a paradoxical way to say it, which is even a better way to than some linear explanation, which it gets confusing real quickly. Because in linear explanations, you get the first part, and then you get the second part, and you say, well, wait a minute. That kind of doesn't fit with the first part now. And you go back to the first, and it gets confusing. But if you use sort of a paradoxical way of speech, then the discursive mind tends to go silent over that. And it doesn't bother you so much. And then you realize, yeah, don't need to discursive mind to explain it to you. Because it's directly experienced. Wow, it's really warming up now. So this is, we'll just take a little cool period here. Let's see if anything else comes up. We talked about how the total governance of the planet does not want anybody to know about the rapture, doesn't want anybody to leave. And if there is a rapture and many people leave, it wants to demonize them so nobody else will leave. It wants to say, you know, those were the bad guys, now they're gone. Congratulations, you didn't fall for the trap. You're here now. Now we're going to have the paradise that we always planned to have here. We got rid of those bad people that were throwing wrenches into it, you know. They hope that those who are partaking of this, you know, death cult of trying to annihilate their spirit, they hope they leave too. Because this funny thing is that those who are loyal to the ego, they conflict with one another. Because they don't like the style, because nothing really works. And they think, well, it doesn't work because you're not, and the ego tells them this. We say to the ego, how come it's not working? They say, well, those people over there, they're not doing the right thing, but you are, or vice versa. So the ego actually creates conflict between different segments of loyalists to the ego. So really in war, you have egoic loyalists battling each other, is what you really have. What interest is that to me, or you, or those who are seeking truth? None. Because what good is the outcome? One egoic loyalist defeats another? What good is that going to do? It still doesn't work, and the ego will raise another different style, and then have them pit those against each other, and saying, you know, have them conflict. It goes on and on and on that way. So sure, for instance, the people of faith in the egoic God and the people atheists, etc., maybe they'll have some big war or something. But both are actually loyal to the ego. Both. And each one goes to the ego and says, how come I can't make you happy? And the ego says, oh, you can. But those other people over there, they're making me very unhappy. So you just got to get rid of them and then I'll be super happy. And then the other group goes to the ego and says, hey, ego, I'm doing everything you tell me to do, but you're still not happy. I'm still afraid of you. What's the matter? What's the matter? They say, well, you are doing everything I asked you to do, and it is working, but those people over there, they're messing everything up terribly, making me super angry. So you just get rid of them, and pff, my anger's dissipated. So you get two groups, each being told the same lie by the ego, and then being told to annihilate one another. And pff, what do you got? You got a conflict, don't you? You absolutely have a conflict. And this is not just sectarian problems among different religious sectarian groups. It's also among atheists, secular humanists, all the egoic loyalists of every flavor variety. There are many, many flavors and varieties of because the ego, nothing works. And so we go to the ego and say, ego, what's the problem? And the ego says, well, let's say you think you've tried everything, and you go to the ego and you say, I'm still terrified of you, you're still very angry with me, I feel like you want to destroy me, so what gives? And the ego say, well, you have tried a lot of stuff, and that's really great, but I was holding something back from you, because I wanted to make sure that you were worthy of this before I told you. This is how the ego talks and says, I have a secret for you. Yeah, I'm only going to tell you because you've been so loyal, and I trust you. And the secret here, this is the actual way that you can make me happy. And everyone's all ears then. And then the ego tells them some crazy scheme or something, of course, that doesn't work. And they think, oh, I finally got the secret. And then they say, tell everybody, hey, I got the secret. This is how to make the ego happy. And that just goes on and on and on and on and on. And when that doesn't work, they go back again and say, wow, I thought this was it. You told me this was it. And it says, well, it was, but there's actually two parts to it. I had to make sure you did the first part right. And now here's the second part. And then you do the second part, same deal, and you come back and say, I did the second part right, the first part right, second part right. And still the same old problem. What's the problem? And the ego says, that's very true. That's very true. Okay. But there's still something I didn't tell you. You need to do part one and part two for a much longer period of time. So you do that, and do that. You finally come back, and you ask the ego, what's going on? He says, okay. The ego says, okay. Now, I know I said that was the final secret, but it was actually just a test for you. It was just a test for you to make sure you were good enough. That he said, this, the ego says, this last secret is so powerful, if you're not ready for it, it'll kill you. So I had to make sure that you were ready for this last part, and I couldn't tell you about it, but this last part is going to kill you if you weren't ready. So now you're ready for it, now I can tell you. So it tells you that part. And of course, that part leads you into complete, total chaos, mental chaos, which ego hopes will cause you to commit suicide, spirit to commit suicide, which doesn't work either. At that point, the ego's finished, because it's played its final card. It leads you all the way down to total chaos, mental chaos. And then you realize the ego's just been playing you for a fool this whole time. You know, and then you're really like saying, uh-oh, I got a continuity problem. Shoot, you know. Because you're hoping that the ego can make it work between the two of you. You can get a beautiful relationship going. And then you realize you can't. You can't. Because when this final step of mental chaos trying to get the spirit to commit suicide doesn't work, then the ego curses you most in the most vile way. And says you're nothing, you're despicable, you're completely incompetent, you're worthless, you know, and just tries to get you to commit spiritual suicide. And then you realize, wow, that's what the ego really wants. That's what it's really after. And then from then, you don't trust the ego anymore. But then you say, oh my gosh, I got this terrible continuity problem. And then you say, oh, what can help me with this continuity problem? This is scary. And then the Holy Spirit shows up in your life. And says, don't worry, I got it covered for you. No worries. He says, you just got to get to work, do the work. Soft landing here. We're headed for a soft landing. Nothing abrupt or harsh, soft landing. And that'll work out perfectly for you. So just do the work and follow along. I'll help you every step of the way. That's the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit eventually aims all your valuing towards the vision of oneness. Vision of oneness. Now, that's the ultimate goal. The rapture, so to speak, is a pragmatic step that may be necessary given the extreme spiritual darkness of this planet that's ready to be plunged into this extreme darkness. I hope it isn't. I hope we can pull back from that brink. But I'm not holding my breath on that. just the very fact that I'm trying my utmost here, and the response is although there's quality response, the quantity is extraordinarily limited. And looking around elsewhere for, there are millions of people saying this? No, absolutely not. I don't know anybody, unfortunately, that's bringing to light this whole, communion thing of what it's really about. How the central bureaucracy is trying to suppress the information about the rapture and doesn't want anybody to know about it. Maybe some people are saying something about that, a few people. But by and large, there's very few people on the planet who are actually willing to speak up at this point. They're very intimidated. Their will has been, severely compromised. There's no question. I feel very tired today because trying to cope up with this pressure is very tiring. So I don't see a likely, positive short-term resolution to what's going on in the world right now, because there's this big leadership push to put those in power who are very loyal to the ego, very super loyal to the ego. That doesn't end well. That results, as I've shown you, in conflict, because the ego will tell each one of these different factions that they're the chosen ones, and the others are the ones that are making the ego angry, so the chosen ones are supposed to go out and annihilate those who are making the ego angry. Ring a bell? Does it ring a bell? Absolutely it rings a bell. Talk about the history of the planet. Each group thinks that they're the ego's chosen one, and the others are the bad guys. They're making the ego angry. If you get the right to go out and conquer their lands and subjugate them, the ego tells them that. Then goes to the enemy and says exactly the same thing to them, and they have this terrible annihilation. The ego all the while is just hoping that this war and this annihilation of bodies will result in spirit dying too, committing suicide or just being wiped out. Spirit. That's the ego's, what the ego's aiming for. So now you know what the history of warfare is all about. How about that? So we're sorting it all out here. And again, it is totally possible to sort it all out. But we don't have to sort every last thing out. But it is possible to sort out some big, very big issues of why the world is so cuckoo. It is totally cuckoo. We keep going to the ego and saying, ego, how can I make you happy? It says, I'm happy with you, but I'm really angry at those other folks, Or, it'll say, well, I'm very unhappy with you because you've not been doing exactly what I told you to. I told you to conquer those people and you didn't do it. Or whatever, So when you put egoic loyalists in charge, leaders, and tell everyone that your salvation is that your goodness and happiness and your civic and legal responsibility is to do what these leaders tell you to do, and these leaders are totally egoic loyalists, you're going to get into conflict because the ego is going to other leaders and tell them the same doggone thing, and saying that you're the one who's bad, that you're not. Doing the right thing, and the ego says, can you help me out? I need to get rid of these people. Just go for it. That's why people go crazy. They're driven by insane fear of the ego, thinking the ego will annihilate them if they don't annihilate the ego's enemies. So you see normal, wonderful people suddenly turning into monsters. We've seen it over and over in history. These people who turn into monsters in warfare, before that, they're probably just regular solid citizens. So don't think that because we have a world full of regular solid citizens that problems will not arise. That has never been the testimony of history. Always the solid citizens and what you think of people are just kind of basically okay. Once they get into that terrified of the ego's going to wipe them out if they don't wipe out the ego's enemies, then they turn into butchers. They turn into. And the motivation comes from all levels of society. You have the people who are egging them on. They say for every grunt on the ground in like Vietnam, there's like 10 people, or 8 or 7, whatever, and modern warfare, even more, in support, behind the scenes, in support roles, supporting the grunt who's out there, doing the fighting. So just because you have a grunt out there doing the fighting, there may be 10 people who are motivating them ferociously to do it. They're basically saying, look, the ego's going to kill me if you don't go out and kill those enemies. And since I'm weak and old, well, I may be weak, I may be young, I may be old, I may not be good at that, I don't want to get my fingernails, break my fingernails or something. And they say, you got to go out and do it because you're this grunt, you're this tough, grizzled, tough guy. You know, you can do the work, but you got to do it for me, because if you don't, I'm gonna lay into you and sabotage you. And so this ferocious demand that the grunts go out there and shoot, that's where the demand comes from more than anything. A lot of these guys on the front lines, they're just saying, wow, you know, I just got pushed here. And I don't dare go back home unless I do wipe out the enemy. Otherwise, I'll never be welcome back in among my family, my group, you know. I got pressured into this. A lot of them are that way. And once they come back home, they never want to talk about it again because they feel terrible about it. That's how warfare happens. You know, it's not all these savage males out there trying to hack each other to pieces. That's not really the full story of the situation. There may be 10 people back home who insist that they go out and be the savage, you know, savage axe wielder. You know, that there may be 10 people, maybe a whole community, you know, saying, you know, you got to do this for us. You got to do this for us. That's a fact. Everybody of an honesty can tell you that is a fact. I mean, most men are not these bloodthirsty savages who say the only thing I want to do is be hacked to pieces on a battlefield. Okay? Occasionally you get the maniacs that way, but they too have been pressured severely. Most of us, we just want to go out and play golf, you know? That's it. We don't want to harm anybody. But the egoic pressures on especially, you know, real able-bodied, tough men are extreme from other members of society, actually. Because those other members of society are absolutely terrified of the ego, saying the ego's going to annihilate us if you don't take care of our enemies. And a lot of times they tell these warrior men who the enemies are. Because these warrior men are just, you know, they just want, you're ready, they've been trained, these Spartans have been trained for action. And then the manipulators behind the scenes will whisper in their ear who it is that they're supposed to get. And of course they're supposedly in contact with God, you know, listening to God, the oracles, listening to God. You say, oh yes, the oracle said at the temple at Delphi or some temple in the out in Asia, oh yeah, God said that these people are your enemies and you must destroy them. And then the word goes out from these high priests and priestesses that this is the enemy, warrior Spartans, do your job. It's like that. It's like that. That's how it really works. So you have these priests and priestesses who are supposedly close to God and can talk to God, and God tells them who is displeasing to God, and then they pass that on to the warrior class. They pass it on to the political bureaucracy. They have channels for all that. And then the warrior class goes out and, you know, tries to smash the enemies. And of course the ego's hoping that both sides will get annihilated, and this will make the ego feel a little less threatened, because the ego's seeing all sorts of annihilation, hoping maybe the spirit got annihilated too. And the idea with Jesus was, well, finally, they say the Son of God finally got killed, now the ego's got to be happy, should be no more warfare, should be peace from now on. Has that happened 2,000 years ago? Have we had peace, perpetual peace from that point on? Oh, there's a problem. We all need to die too. We all need to eat the dead butt flesh and blood and die also. So we haven't done that yet. So that's why there hasn't been peace. Oh, I see. Yeah. That doesn't quite add up, does it? Yeah, I think the explanation I've given is the one that is very clear. That you cannot appease the ego. You cannot offer a sexual sacrifice to the ego. It's impossible. Totally impossible. We've gotten played for fools. We've been played for fools. But obviously we have something within us which is not a fool, okay? Otherwise, how could I have clarified it? It's not, see, there is something within us that can get it, can say, wow, I tricked myself. I was just deceiving myself. I was just projecting all this. But now what do? I got a continuity problem now. Well, the Holy Spirit relieves our fear of the continuity problem progressively, then tells you, look, the vision of oneness will absolutely, finally cure you of the depths of your continuity problem. That's your goal. That is your goal. And so we have within us the capacity to recognize our mistakes and then accept the correction for them. We absolutely do. But on a planet that is dedicated to insisting we don't have that capacity, it's not an easy go, that is for sure. So I would just say that it's not improbable that what Jesus said when he left is accurate. Now, he didn't say anything in the Course in Miracles for some reason. I said that there's probably a reason for that. Didn't want to place an undue burden upon us. Okay, the Course in Miracles was enough burden already. But certainly you don't want to get the government bureaucracy targeting you by saying that the rapture is going to happen and you need to prepare for all this kind of stuff. They don't like that at all. So I think it would have been way too much of a burden about what's going to happen, other than generalized stuff that you better be prepared for something. Okay, something is coming up. And I have gotten very subtle clues from the Holy Spirit that, yeah, this is what's going to happen for sure. But it has not given me anything that I could feed anybody, you know, exactly this is it. Probably to just protect me, my stress levels, really. Because you don't really want to be too far out there in the lead on all this, trying to absorb all the wrath of the world on this, you know. Now it's probably so close to happening that it's not a big issue. That's maybe why I'm saying it now. They can't be stopped, but what they want to do is limit the numbers that are raptured, because again they want solid tax-paying citizens to stay right where they are and keep supporting the apparatus of government and really the apparatus of control and really the apparatus of the egoic defensive, where the ego's telling, this is what I want, this is what I want, this is what I want. God did not make impermanence, did not make this planet. I was reading A Course in Miracles today, and Jesus is absolutely emphatically clear about this. Over and over and over and over, God had absolutely nothing to do with making this realm of impermanence. This terrible, nightmarish world and place, nothing to do with it. We made it. It's our projection. So you wouldn't think that God is saying, well, you need this, this is your place, this is your home, you're supposed to be happy here and all this kind of stuff. That doesn't make any sense at all. Now, you certainly, the vision of oneness will make you happy, for sure. You can do that here. But it's not a given that you will under the pressures of the situation here. Severe pressure. I mean, I can't even get it. I've seen glimpses of it, but I'm not abiding in it. And abidance in it is the goal. I'm not aware of very many people who are abiding it, if any. There may be someone in India, some teacher that never heard of before, seems as though he may be abiding in it. Seems that way. But he's in some little town up in some mountain and just, you know, just very, not very much in the mainstream of anything. You know, here and there may be some adepts that are abiding in it, but they're not out in the open so much as that I can see. It's limited. It's limited here. So maybe there will be this parting of the ways, this sorting out period. There needs to be a sorting out because, you know, when the ego makes this play for total darkness, then those who say no to that, who have a strong enough will to say, that's not my choice, my power of decision is with me, and I choose the Holy Spirit in His path, then there has to be a sorting out taking place. Because when you globalize the ego's position to such an extent it can impose its will on everyone on the planet, or at least try to, then again, you need a sorting out. Sorting out has to take place. Otherwise, both sides are going to feel very uncomfortable. Now, I don't have any desire to make those who want spiritual darkness to follow the ego's plan. I have no desire to make them feel uncomfortable. They have every right to continue to play this whimsical game, adventure game that they're playing. So I don't feel angry at them. Doesn't bother me that what they're doing. But conversely, it's not the same. It probably bothers them extremely what I'm doing and what and the direction I decided to go. I know from my own life it does bother them extremely. So I don't want them to be bothered by me. But I'm certainly not going to give up my clarity. So I think the best remedy is to sort things out. Go through a sorting out period. Because if they want to continue to play the silly, whimsical game of appeasing the ego for however long they want to, fine. It doesn't affect me at all. It doesn't affect reality. It doesn't change, you know, how I feel about anything. But it certainly does pressure those who want to get out of it into feeling that they can't. So it cannot be left totally unaddressed. However, since they want it to be totally unaddressed at this point, it may make them feel too uncomfortable to have anybody even addressing it here, you know? They may take drastic action to get rid of anybody who makes them feel the slightest bit to address this and makes them feel uncomfortable. They may really want to get rid of them at this point. If that's the case, then for sure, we'll go somewhere else and we'll wait until they've cooled down and they've decided, you know, we gotta find a better way. We've gotta choose again. We've gotta turn to the whole, we've hit rock bottom, help. Oh, I have a terrible continuity problem. Oh, bingo. Then the help arises. I say, hey, yeah, let's work on the continuity problem. Because that's where it's really at. That's the spiritual path. That's where it's really at. We do have a continuity problem. That can be worked on. Trying to appease the ego is like doing nothing. It's totally futile. It can't really be worked on at all. But the continuity problem can be worked on. That's what I've done. A lifetime of it, really. A lifetime of it. But I'd say, was it 40, I don't know how long, 48 years or something? Or no, sorry, I'm going to say. I can't even do the math right now. Anyway, it's been 46 years, let's call it 46 years of intense work on it. And so it can be done. That's what can be done. Working on the continuity problem is what we can do. Appeasing the ego is impossible. We get nowhere. I've noticed these people who have gone in that direction. Nothing. They're just like angry and perplexed, and they're still like saying, ego, who do I need to spite to appease, you know? Who's getting you angry? The same old question. Hey, ego, I've done everything you asked me to do. Why am I still feeling this way? Who's making you angry? Oh, they are? Okay, I'll get rid of them. Same old. Hasn't it dawned on them what the whole deal is? I feel fine, tired, for sure tired, because I feel that there's this, you know, deadline coming up, actually. It's only a few days away, and we need to really push it at this point, really push it, which is what I'm doing. This information here is, like I said at the beginning of the video, you're going to get an earful in this video. You're going to get an earful. Hopefully you have gotten an earful. But I feel calm, smooth, you know, no worries. Of course, who knows how people are going to react, I don't know. Hopefully in a calm, smooth way. And they'll start thinking, huh, yeah, I do have a continuity, but I see the continuity problem is really my only problem. The ego's not a problem, really, because it's futile. So if something's futile, is it really a problem? No, because you can't work on it. But the definition of problem is something you can work on, really. I mean, otherwise, it's kind of meaningless. It kind of means you got nothing, no recourse. That's worse than a problem. I say we have a problem means we can work on it. So the continuity problem is a problem we can work on. The ego is not a problem we can work on. We cannot. So we have to turn away from the ego and say, that's futile, absolutely futile. Let's work on the continuity problem with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our new advisor, okay? And I wish you would give me more advice, but it is so humble and circumspect that it only gives you what you can handle. And, you know, it just stays in the background to an unbelievable extent. The Holy Spirit is just the absolute model of humility. You know, it's just, it has no, you know, no need to be appeased or we need to do something for the Holy. No. It's just whatever you can handle, it then helps clarify you. So, it's like the invisible advisor, kind of. And I say, well, where? What are you doing for me? I don't see anything. we'll see what's next, you know? We'll see what's next. All right. Hopefully something great. I could really use something really great right now. All right. This has been a great video. I told you I would come through with it. And now let's see if I can get it posted. And let's see if you can view it. And realize that we do have a problem. We have a continuity problem. We do have an advisor that can help us with this problem, which is the Holy Spirit. We do have the ultimate remedy for this problem, which is a vision of oneness. We do have the spiritual will to use the power of our decision to choose the vision of oneness. We do have that. And we may have an ace up our sleeve should the world be plunged into severe spiritual darkness. We may have an alternative dwelling place too, and a way to get there actually. That is also possible. So I'm not saying for sure that's going to happen. The other stuff is 100% for sure. But as far as how exactly the future plays out, we need to at least be aware of what some options, what some possibilities could be. Okay? And I've also realized that it's possible to clarify all this stuff. We have it within us. We do have the capacity. The reason is within us. We have this capacity to see with the eyes of reason and see the situation. Say, ah, so that's how I got tricked. That's how I deceived myself. Oh my gosh, that was really very heavy deception, was self-deception. We're suffering from self-deception, but really the problem is the continuity problem. The problem we have is the continuity problem. I don't have a self-deception problem, I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The vision of one that solves the continuity problem. The self-deception, it has no value to me. The self-deception problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Value towards the vision of oneness. Very great. That is it.